I was in the Indian police 5 years, and by the end of that time, I hated the imperialism I was serving with a bitterness which I probably cannot make clear. In order to hate imperialism, you have got to be part of it.
George Orwell is among the 20th century's most celebrated writers. He is remembered for his massively popular books Animal Farm and 1984. His writings covered subjects such as totalitarianism, socialism, Englishness, political language, popular culture, poverty, the Spanish Civil War, and imperialism, the first political cause he became concerned with. His story is that of a colonial dissident, a police officer in Burma who turned against the imperial system he had served. His writings on imperialism are among his most memorable and moving. From his two celebrated essays, A Hanging and Shooting an Elephant, to his first novel, Burmese Days, colonialism was an important personal and political force in Orwell's life, and by understanding his life, we might come to understand something of the nature of imperialism itself.
George Orwell, whose real name was Eric Arthur Blair, belonged to a family with deep colonial roots. In distant centuries, his ancestors had made their fortune in the Jamaican sugar trade. By the Victorian era, his grandparents belonged to the professional middle class. Both grandfathers had worked in India. One was a priest in Calcutta who served in the Indian Army, the other a teak merchant and shipbuilder based in Moulmein, Burma. Eric's father, Richard Blair, served in India as a middling agent in the opium department, resolutely committed in his faith to the empire. Eric's mother, Ida Limousine, was born in Moulmein to a household which boasted of 30 Burmese servants. But by the time of her adulthood, hardship had spurred her to marry the much older Richard. The couple moved to Motihari in northern India, near Nepal, where Eric Blair was born in 1903. It was standard for Anglo-Indian families to send their children back to Britain for their upbringing. So, Ida went with Eric Blair to England while Richard continued his work in India. Young Blair was educated in prestigious boarding schools, including Eton, where he was fed a constant diet of porridge, patriotism, and Kipling. The latter became a lifelong fascination. As a boy, Blair wrote parodies of Kipling's poem If, and greatly admired his novel Kim. It is easy to picture a teenage Blair's imagination being fired up by the road to Mandalay, which a mature Orwell admitted to still enjoying.
By the old Moulmein pagoda, looking lazy at the sea, there's a Burma girl a-sitting, and I know she thinks of me. For the wind is in the palm trees, and the temple bells they say, come you back, you British soldier. Come you back to Mandalay.
One of Blair's attorney and friends recalled him expressing a romantic longing to return to the East someday. Such sentiments, combined with his unimpressive grades and pressure from the now returned Richard, led Orwell to sit an examination for the Indian Imperial Police in 1922 at the age of 19, a humble career for an attorney and graduate. The police exams tested Blair on his Greek and Latin, his knowledge of English history, and his drawing and horse-riding abilities, proving that he was indeed quite the English gentleman. But curiously, there were no questions about either India or policing. Admitted to the force, Blair preferenced Burma as his posting over India because his grandmother still resided in Moulmein. Burma had only been fully acquired by the British as recently as 1885, with smaller pieces won in the 1820s and 50s. Burma was never given provincial status, and unlike other British possessions, was not governed using local rulers, but directly. Burma missed out on the Montague-Chelmsford reforms of 1919, which were extended to the rest of India. This sparked mass protests from Burmese students and Buddhist monks, as well as a boycott of British goods. Though by the 1920s the situation had calmed, deep seeds of antipathy between the Burmese and British had been planted. It was to such a land that Blair sailed on an ocean liner, departing on October 27, 1922. The ship briefly stopped in Colombo, Ceylon, which enchanted Orwell with its eastern charm. It also offered Blair his first glimpse of imperial rule. As the ship was being unloaded, a local luggage handler was clumsily carrying a tin uniform case. Seeing this, a British officer kicked him squarely in the bottom, sending him staggering across the deck, the approval of the onlooking passengers. In November, Blair landed in Rangoon, and then travelled up the Irrawaddy to Mandalay, where he undertook 6 months of police training. Far from an oriental paradise, he later wrote of the place,
"Mandalay is a rather disagreeable town. It is dusty and intolerably hot, and it is said to have five main products all beginning with P, namely pagodas, pariahs, pigs, priests, and prostitutes."
He was quartered in a dorm in the police training school, a few doors away from a room which had been left empty ever since a dissatisfied police officer had committed suicide some months before. The mornings consisted of intensive drilling, followed by classes on police procedure in the afternoons. Blair was made to learn both Hindustani and Burmese, which he proved adept at. By the end of his time in Burma, he was said to be able to discuss philosophy with Buddhist bonzes in high-flown Burmese. He also picked up a more obscure Shaw Karen language, an impressive feat for a young officer. Blair seems to have been a somewhat lonely figure, who preferred to retreat to his room to read in the evenings, rather than dance or socialise. Almost everyone who met Blair in Burma describes him as an awkward figure, gaunt, with ill-fitting clothes. He was also considered eccentric, unclubbable, as some people scoffed. But it would be wrong to portray Blair as a complete outcast. He was generally admitted to be a pleasant, good-humoured man who could on occasion be the life of the party. During his time in Mandalay, he made the acquaintance of the rather free-spirited Captain H.R. Robinson. He was a similarly young Englishman who had been in Burma only 1 year. Within just 2 more years, Robinson became a suicidal opium addict. From Mandalay, Blair was sent to the cooler alpine town of Mamio, a Victorian resort town reminiscent of rural England. He was struck by the green grass, the mossy fir trees, and the hill women who sold fresh strawberries. He was attached to an army brigade there, composed mainly of Great War veterans whom Blair admired, but not without recoiling at the stench of their lower-class sweat. But it was in January of 1924 that he was sent to his first independent posting, the town of Myangmia in the Irrawaddy Delta, west of Rangoon. It was an isolated place, flat and marshy, only accessible by boat. By all accounts, a bad posting. One of Blair's close friends from England remembered the letters she received from him about how awful life in Burma was. He would have been lonely. Virtually the only Europeans at Myangmia were American Baptist missionaries who had a college nearby. Once, a missionary came into the police station and saw a Burmese sub-inspector harassing a suspect. The American turned to Blair and said, "I wouldn't care to have your job." A mature Orwell later remembered,
"It made me horribly ashamed. So that was the kind of job I had. Even an arse of an American missionary, a teetotal cock virgin from the Middle West, had the right to look down on me and pity me."
After a few months in Myangmia, he was moved to Twente, just east of Rangoon. Another fairly sleepy locale, it consisted mainly of mosquito-infested mangrove swamps. Blair spent his time travelling from village to village to check up on village heads and sub-inspectors, with a retinue of cooks and servants in tow. He was known to sometimes visit a church of the local Karen people, and was thought quite eccentric for doing so. The few Europeans who met him in Twente remember him as unremarkable, pleasant, but shy. Though it was undoubtedly a lonely posting, he did take the opportunity to visit Rangoon when he could, immersing himself in the local bookshops. It was from one such visit that we have our only Burmese account of Blair. Maung Shin Aung, a Burmese scholar, then a 15-year-old schoolboy, was at a Rangoon train station on a golden November afternoon. Blair was walking down the steps towards the station platform when one of Aung's schoolmates accidentally bumped into Blair, who was tripped up and sent tumbling down the stairs. In a fury, Blair lifted up his cane to strike the boy in the head, but checked himself the last second and instead hit him on the back. Aung and a group of schoolmates began protesting to Blair about his treatment of the schoolboy, and the argument continued once Blair had boarded the train, though he eventually managed to calm the situation down. Elsewhere, Blair admitted to hitting servants, bullying subordinates, and snubbing village elders. From such incidents, some have inferred a streak of brutalism, sadism even, in Blair's character, which his time as a policeman exacerbated. From Twente, Blair was moved to Sirayam in early 1925. Here, Blair was put in charge of the security of the substantial refineries of the British-owned Burma Oil Company. Life at the refinery was uneventful, the heavy drinking and hard gambling American oil drillers adding the only colour. From Sirayam, Blair was able to make further visits to Rangoon. One evening there, he met Christopher Hollis, a Cambridge student passing through Burma. The two wound up in a discussion about British rule in Burma. Hollis remembered that Orwell repeated typical phrases about keeping the Burmese in line, that a beating here or there was necessary, and so on. This falls in line with other accounts from those who knew him. There seemed nothing unconventional in the views of this quiet English officer, and no sign of any liberal opinions. Another man who knew Blair at this time claimed that he was a frequent visitor to Rangoon's riverside brothels. A friend from later in life claimed Orwell once spoke to him at length about the beauty of Burmese women. A poem penned by Blair during or soon after his time in Burma, titled Romance, is especially revealing.
When I was young and had no sense, in far-off Mandalay, I lost my heart to a Burmese girl as lovely as the day. Her skin was gold, her hair was jet, her teeth were ivory. I said for 20 silver pieces, maiden, sleep with me. She looked at me, so pure, so sad, the loveliest thing alive, and in her lisping virgin voice stood out for 25.
In September of 1925, Blair was moved to Insein, north of Rangoon. Here was situated Burma's second largest prison, a massive circular complex which Blair would have frequently visited. The scene disturbed him greatly.
The wretched prisoners squatting in the reeking cages of the lockups, the grey-cowed faces of the long-term convicts, the scarred buttocks of the men who had been flogged with bamboos, the women and children howling when their manfolk were led away under arrest. Things like these are beyond bearing when you are in any way directly responsible for them. I never went to jail without feeling that my place was on the other side of the bars.
Throughout his time in Burma, Blair witnessed many such horrors. He was at the forefront of the crime wave convulsing Burma in the 1920s, which saw a marked increase in murders. Years later, Orwell criticised W.H. Auden for using the phrase necessary murder in the poem Spain.
Personally, I would not speak so lightly of murder. It so happens that I have seen the bodies of numbers of murdered men. Therefore, I have some conception of what murder means. The terror, the hatred, the howling relatives, the postmortems, the blood, the smells.
It was most likely at the Insein prison that Blair witnessed the hanging of a prisoner, which he described as worse than 1,000 murders. His disillusionment with the British Empire was beginning, but it had to be kept secret. Anti-imperial sentiments were not socially tolerated. He began to wallow in the contradictions of being an agent of justice for an imperial rule he thought unjust. Blair's eccentricities also became more noticeable in this period. A colleague of his, who visited his house in Insein, saw that Blair had given over the bottom floor to an assortment of goats, geese, and ducks. After Insein came Moulmein, where Blair was stationed from April of 1926. Located in the country's southeast, at the mouth of the Salween River, Moulmein was Burma's third largest town. He was the subdivisional officer of the town, a reasonably important rank. Blair had family in Moulmein from his mother's side, a grandmother and an aunt, and Blair became a frequent attendee to his grandmother's parties. He was appalled to learn that despite having lived almost half her life in Burma, his grandmother did not speak a word of Burmese. The police football team was another mainstay of Blair's time in Moulmein. He was known to be a skillful centre-forward who netted many goals. But there was one rather sour incident in which he was tripped over by an opposing Burmese player. The referee, also Burmese, overlooked the foul, much to the delight of the hooting Burmese crowd. Blair was often baited in Moulmein. The town was an epicentre for Buddhists, as it was home to many historic pagodas and monasteries, and the many Buddhist monks, still resentful of British rule, did not hesitate to jeer and harass the Europeans, especially the police officers. Blair hated the monks with a passion, often fantasizing of plunging a bayonet into their stomachs. In December of 1926, Blair was moved to the other side of the country, to the remote town of Kata in Upper Burma, well north of Mandalay. He seems to have been sent there under unusual circumstances. It was whispered that Blair had shot an elephant and was moved in punishment. On the rail journey to the new posting, he shared a room with a man from the educational service.
Half an hour's cautious questioning decided each of us that the other was safe. And then for hours, we damned the British Empire, damned it from the inside, intelligently and intimately. But we had been speaking forbidden things, and in the haggard morning light, when the train called into Mandalay, we parted as guiltily as any adulterous couple.
Whatever the circumstances of his transfer, Kata proved to be quite different from his southern postings. He was struck by its beauty. Lush jungles opened up into fields of meadows. All around were peepal trees, palm trees, and bougainvilleas. But with only a few Europeans in town, life was quiet and uneventful. His health became increasingly fragile. Blair contracted dengue fever at some point during his service, and it was probably in Burma that he contracted tuberculosis. Because of such ailments, in July 1927, Blair was granted over 5 months of sick leave in Britain. By now, Blair had no desire to continue his service, and so he resigned from the police upon returning to Britain. He later explained his decision as partly a matter of health, partly because he wanted to become a writer, but mainly because he did not wish to serve in imperialism he thought no better than a racket. Adjusting to life in Britain was not easy for Blair. His family noticed that he kept dropping his cigarette butts on the floor of their house. He was used to having servants clean up after him. Much as he hated it, he had also come to love Burma and didn't quite feel at home in Britain.
The peculiar double homesickness, which is the punishment for deserting your native land, live among the palm trees and the mosquitoes in savage sunshine, in the smell of garlic and the creaking of bullock cart wheels, and you pine for the sight of a single snowdrop, or a frozen pond, or a red pillar box. Come back to Europe, and all you can remember is the blood-red flowers of the hibiscus, and the flying foxes streaming overhead.
His time in Burma had changed him enormously. Gone were the chubby cheeks of his youth. Left behind was a more raddled figure. A man who was haunted by the face of the Burmese prisoners he had roughed up and locked away. By now his antipathy to imperialism was well developed, and he began his first steps to put them down to paper. He made sketches for a novel, one which would expose the reality of Burma, the prejudices, the loneliness, the despotism, the heat, and the harrowingly beautiful landscapes. But while such ideas were stewing in his mind, Blair began writing his first articles on Burma. In May of 1929, he penned an article for the radical Parisian journal Le Progrès Civique, titled How a Nation is Exploited, The British Empire in Burma. This rather plain essay systematically examines the Burmese landscape, its people and resources, and the British administration. We see in it his first expressions of socialist thought. He argues that British rule is despotic and self-interested, seeking only exploitation, and that any benefits the Burmese get from colonial rule are incidental to the quest for wealth. The British not only plunder Burma for its resources, but have quashed Burmese manufacturing, creating an artificial dependency in which Burma is reliant on British imports, giving the British a monopoly which they can supply at will. In exchange, the Burmese receive military protection, though this is a poor bargain, and the military is usually used to subdue the Burmese themselves. 2 years later, Blair wrote his first essay of any great renown, A Hanging. It details a scene which probably occurred in the prison at Insein, or perhaps the one at Moulmein. With a precision of narrative and a lucidity of prose, the details slowly build to create the scene of a golden, rain-sodden morning in which a wispy Hindu prisoner is being led out of his cell to the gallows. Between the grip of two Indian soldiers, the prisoner manages to step around a puddle in his path.
It is curious, but till that moment I had never realized what it means to destroy a healthy, conscious man. When I saw the prisoner step aside to avoid the puddle, I saw the mystery, the unspeakable wrongness, of cutting short a life when it is in full tide. This man was not dying. He was alive, just as we were alive. He and we were a party of men walking together, seeing, hearing, feeling, understanding the same world. And in 2 minutes, with a sudden snap, one of us would be gone. One mind less, one world less.
For just a moment, the divisions of race and civilization were vanquished, replaced with the universal humanism so crucial to Orwell's eventual worldview. As the noose is tied around the prisoner's neck, he screams, "Ram! Ram! Ram!" for minutes on end, until finally he plunges to his death. It was just one example of the despotism which Blair believed made a lie of the civilizing mission colonialism claimed to stand for. In order to rule over barbarians, you have got to become a barbarian yourself, as he once wrote. Throughout the late 20s and early 30s, Blair had been working on a large project. He had demons to settle. He later wrote that the landscape of Burma haunted him like a nightmare, and he wrote a novel simply to rid it from his mind. Burmese Days was published in 1934 in America. No British publisher would touch it, for fear of libel. It was published under the name George Orwell, Blair's new pen name and subsequent literary persona. Burmese Days is an endlessly pessimistic work. It is set in Chaktada, Upper Burma, a fictionalized version of Kata, where there are only 7 Europeans whose lives revolve around the club, an exclusively white establishment. Though situated in a foreign land and culture, they are shockingly insular people, associating only with each other. They fill their days with endless drinking. Booze is the cement of empire, as one character says. The protagonist is John Florey, a logger in his 30s who has turned against the British Empire, though he cannot admit this to his club fellows, who he despises anyway. He hates Ellis especially, who is practically Hitlerian in how violent his racism is, screaming in furious tirades about the niggers and starting a riot by thrashing a Burmese schoolboy in the face with a rod, blinding him. Florey is regarded by others as a Bolshie, who has gone native, as he mingles occasionally with the locals. He also enjoys the company of a Burmese mistress, Mahlamay. Christopher Hitchens points out the hypocrisy in all this.
The most qualified and educated Burmese man would never be allowed as a member of the English club in town, hard as he might try. But the least educated Burmese woman would be admitted to the British colonial officer's mansion by the back door as, well, at best, a mistress. In fact, Florey has, it turns out, actually bought his woman as a concubine from her family, so she's in effect something like a comfort woman or a slave.
The Burmese are often presented as worse than their imperial overlords. Upo Khin is the disgustingly venal magistrate of Chaktada. Fat from his insatiable greed, he enjoys nothing more than intrigue and robbing pretty youths of their virginity. And for some reason, the Burmese always seem to reek of garlic. But the Burmese are not really Orwell's focus. The Europeans are. If nothing else, Burmese Days is an expose of the despotism not only perpetrated by the Pukka Sahibs, or English masters, but felt by them.
It is a stifling, stultifying world in which to live. It is a world in which every word and thought is censored. Free speech is unthinkable. All other kinds of freedom are permitted. You are free to be a drunkard, an idler, a coward, a backbiter, a fornicator, but you are not free to think for yourself. Your opinion on every subject of conceivable importance is dictated for you by the Pukka Sahib's code. Year after year, you sit in Kipling-haunted little clubs, listening and eagerly agreeing while Colonel Bodger develops his theory that these bloody nationalists should be boiled in oil. You hear your Oriental friends called greasy little baboos, and you admit dutifully that they are greasy little baboos. You are a creature of the despotism, a Pukka Sahib, tied tighter than a monk or a savage by an unbreakable system of taboos.
In all this power play and censorship, there is a foreshadowing of 1984. By understanding the relationship of the dominated and the dominator, Christopher Hitchens argues that Orwell's experience of colonialism had allowed him to decode British class structure and fascism later in life.
was he knew that there was a filthy secret at the heart of power, and that that secret was in a sense a pornographic secret, that some people don't even need the excuse to wield power. They won't even say, we're doing it for your own good or to civilize your colony. We're in power because we like it. We're in power because we enjoy punishing people. We're in power because we enjoy owning people. We enjoy telling them what they can do. We enjoy telling them when we feel like having sex with them and when we don't. We do this for its own sake. And I think it was a tremendous advantage to Orwell as a writer to have understood this right from the start, to strip away the hypocrisy that underlies authority.
Hitchens captures well how Orwell understood the master-slave relationship, but Orwell went further than that and makes a more unique and radical point. He realized that the master who wields absolute power is themselves enslaved. Enslaved by the expectations of the dominated and having to keep rank with the other dominators in an endless game of saving face and maintaining the aura of power. The master, by definition, cannot be independent, as they are dependent on the slave and the collusion of the other masters for their power. This was the point of Orwell's second autobiographical essay on Burma, Shooting an Elephant. In Moulmein, a work elephant in must is rampaging, killing a cow, flattening a bamboo hut, raiding a fruit shop, and horrifically mangling a Dravidian labourer. By the time Orwell catches up to the elephant, it is calmly chewing grass in a field. But behind Orwell is a crowd of some 2,000 Burmese following him to witness the elephant get shot and snag some free meat. Orwell realizes he must shoot the elephant merely to satisfy the crowd, even though it is no longer a threat.
And it was at this moment, as I stood there with the rifle in my hands, that I first grasped the hollowness, the futility of the white man's dominion in the East. Here was I, the white man with his gun, standing in front of the unarmed native crowd, seemingly the leading actor of the piece, but in reality, I was only an absurd puppet, pushed to and fro by the will of those yellow faces behind. I perceived at this moment that when the white man turns tyrant, it is his own freedom that he destroys. He becomes a sort of hollow, posing dummy, the conventionalized figure of a sahib, for it is the condition of his rule that he shall spend his life in trying to impress the natives, and so in every crisis, he has got to do what the natives expect of him. He wears a mask, and his face grows to fit it.
He shoots the elephant 5 times, missing the vital organs, leaving it panting painfully on the ground for 30 minutes before it finally bleeds to death. The Burmese strip it to the bone, while the Europeans debate over whether Orwell had done the right thing. For the rest of his life, his experience of Burma served as a point of reference for his subsequent adventures. It must have had an extraordinary grip on his mind. In Wigan, we find Orwell comparing the caravan camps to the slums of Burma. In Spain, likening the train from the front lines to Barcelona, to the ride from Mandalay to Mamio, and during the war, equating the aeroplanes over London to swatting tropical mosquitoes. In 1938, Orwell was once again plunged into the world of colonialism. This time it was French Morocco, where he travelled in the hopes its warm, dry climate would ease his lung troubles. His wife stayed with him in Morocco, though apparently this did not stop him from consorting with the local ladies. He also wrote about his experiences in late 1939 in the essay Marrakesh. In it, he describes the astounding poverty of the Moroccan poor, how fly-blown the streets were, and how the graveyards were little more than a collection of dusty pits. He dwells on just how invisible the subject people are to a colonialist. The Europeans' eyes soak up the palm trees and the soil, but not the street beggars. When he once offered an old wicker woman some money, she gasped at the fact he had taken notice of her, as though in doing so he had broken some law of nature. The essay ends with Orwell watching a parade of Senegalese troops march through town, wondering how long it will be until they turn their guns against their white masters. With the outbreak of World War II, Orwell believed there was a new opportunity for a reworking of Britain's colonial system. Orwell never tired of pointing out the hypocrisy of those who denounced Nazi atrocities without having anything to say about the atrocities committed by the British Empire overseas. He had come to regard imperialism as an extension of reactionary capitalism. Just as it exploited the poor at home, it degraded much of the world's population abroad. In 1941, Orwell began working for the Indian section of the BBC's Eastern Service in London. His job was to broadcast what was essentially British propaganda to the now besieged Indian subcontinent on the front lines of Japan's westward expansion across Burma. He was pessimistic about it. In the first place, very few Indians had the means or interest to listen in. But Orwell often found his broadcasts were censored and the BBC would frequently backflip on who was politically acceptable. His time at the BBC served as a direct inspiration for the Ministry of Information in 1984, whose role is, of course, to misinform. Though Orwell believed India's interests were to remain with the Allies, he was dismayed at the arrest of the Indian Congress leaders in August of 1942. At the BBC, Orwell again found himself an agent of imperialism, only this time it was a softer mode of cultural imperialism. One benefit of the work was the chance to collaborate with such figures as E.M. Forster, T.S. Eliot, and Malk Rajanad. By now, Orwell had a particular interest in the emergent field of English language Indian literature. He closely followed the fate of Indian independence. In one of his last essays, Reflections on Gandhi, he expressed admiration for Gandhi's efforts in ending British rule and his universal egalitarianism, but felt that Gandhi's asceticism was anti-human and reactionary. After the war, Orwell turned his attention to writing his greatest masterpiece, 1984, which has been called the culmination of his life's work, touching on all of the political causes dear to him, imperialism among them. The three totalitarian superstates jostle for control of the equatorial front, which stretches in a quadrilateral, with its corners at Tangier, Brazzaville, Darwin, and Hong Kong, containing within it about a fifth of the population of the Earth. These colonial battles are dutifully reported by the telescreens.
Attention, your attention please. A newsflash has this moment arrived from the Malabar front. Our forces in South India have won a glorious victory. I'm authorized to say that the action we are now reporting may well bring the war within measurable distance to its end.
These foreign conflicts have little direct bearing on the lives of the people of Oceania beyond the occasional rocket bombing and a slight increase in the tea rations. But there are deeper interests involved. The conquest of colonies is an important source of resources and manpower, yes, but the deeper reason the war is fought is because the superstates find the state of being at war convenient. The real war is being waged against the people, the foreign wars merely a means to keep them subservient and their standard of living low. There can be no end to the war, for, as the slogan says, war is peace. The destruction and exploitation of foreign lands and people is incidental, and ultimately the colonial holdings disposable. Such was Orwell's vision of imperialism in a totalitarian future. By late 1949, Orwell's tuberculosis worsened, and he was hospitalized. Even now, his mind turned back to Burma. Though instructed by his doctors not to write, he summoned up the strength to sketch the outline of one last novel, a smoking room story set on an ocean liner bound for Britain from Rangoon in the 1920s. It follows Curly Johnson, a young plantation worker returning to Britain from Burma, sacked for drunkenness, it is rumoured. Burma dwells heavily on Curly's mind, the bungalow, the mission, the plantation. On the deck, colonial millionaires lounge lazily, and young missionary boys restively anticipate their postings. The ship's smoking room is filled with drunk American oil drillers, keen gamblers, who vie with the British to be the most offensive. In this case, the British win. But a smoking room story was never to be written. George Orwell died on January 21st, 1950, aged just 46. In the 70 years since his death, he has rightly been called a pioneer and founder of post-colonialism, and his essays are considered classics in that field, keenly read by students everywhere. In Burma, he is remembered with a mixture of admiration and unease. Some have taken issue with his portrayal of the Burmese people, but politics in modern Myanmar has perpetuated his relevance. There is a joke among the Burmese people that Orwell wrote not just one novel about the country, but three, a trilogy comprising of Burmese Days, Animal Farm, and 1984. Perhaps fittingly, the Burmese people seem to feel the same love-hate relationship towards Orwell as he felt towards Burma and its people. As for us, We should appreciate the courage it took to turn against imperialism when it was unpopular to do so, and in a place where it was socially unacceptable to do so. The sheer power with which he describes what he witnessed, and his dedication to a universal humanism which finds the subjugation of any human being offensive, should, I think, earn Orwell some of our praise, and perhaps even our admiration.